Hello, everyone. I'm James Valvano, and welcome to another episode of We Have a Face TV. Before I get into today's show topic and our incredible special guest, I want to give a shout out to all of my HDJHD warriors and caregivers. It has been an amazing week because we have seen so many people support the current project we have right now to make a major change and revision to the current diagnostic criteria for HD. It is a dream come true for so many of us who have been in the trenches since, you know, 2009 or even 20 years ago, that we're actually having this conversation. And we have a super amazing team of medical professionals who are on the side of change. And we also have amazing organizations all over the planet that are starting to join and become an effective part of this puzzle piece that we're putting together. So I want to thank you, and please continue to visit wehaveaface.org/change. You'll get as much information there, signing the petition, upload your video, but enough of that. But now we're on to one of my favorite friends and education partners is Louise Vetter, CEO and president of HDSA. Louise, welcome to the show. Thank you so much.
Hi, James. Thanks for having me.
It's always great to have you on the show. It's a great time in life right now. Before we go into the topic of today's show, I want to ask you, because HDSA is playing a key role in looking forward to changing the diagnostic criteria. If you could take a moment and speak to our patients, caregivers, and medical community and organizations as to your opinion, feelings, and how important this project is.
Wow. Well, this is the biggest project, I think, sort of challenge in front of the HD community right now. And it's why I'm so glad to be working with you and all of our partners around the globe to tackle this question of what diagnosis for Huntington's disease should look like based on what we know about the disease. So at HDSA, we're a science-driven organization. We're informed by the medical facts, and the facts tell us time and time again that Huntington's disease is not just a motor disease, right? We know that. We've known that forever, and the science continues to add to that story, right? And so at HDSA, we are constantly looking at how we can support families through the entire journey of HD, right? So it's the life spectrum from living at risk to being, you know, pre-early and symptomatic, all the challenges of being a caregiver, and then end of life planning, and then the cycle starts over again. And there's so much more that goes into that, right? So juvenile HD, genetic testing, the questions, the complications of being part of an HD family are endless. And in our work as an organization trying to support all of that, we're constantly talking with doctors and clinical scientists about what it means to help families. And part of that is understanding what diagnosis for HD should look like. So we all know that historically it's been categorized as a motor disease. We understand that. It makes sense based on practice and science and what is easy to measure. But HD isn't easy. It's why the HDSA Centers of Excellence are built around comprehensive care teams that are neurologists, often motor disease specialists, psychiatrists, psychologists, and social workers, right? So we know that HD isn't just motor by the fact that every Center of Excellence has to have a social worker that helps families as they navigate everything, including the cognitive and behavioral challenges of the disease.
Absolutely. So
it's time for the diagnostic criteria to be looked at with fresh eyes to make sure that it's including the full spectrum of the disease. And so that's why when we, you know, started to hear the great project that you're doing and all of the stories you're collecting, It really just continued to build this snowball of, okay, we need to come together again and talk about this. And that's why I'm so passionate about this project.
Absolutely. And you know, for full disclosure, you and I spoke prior, the HDSA for a very long time has always looked at this in that manner. We have amazing medical professionals at centers of excellence who are already doing what we're wanting as to be the baseline for the new or revised diagnostic criteria. And so it's a beautiful thing when we have seasoned medical professionals who, in this case, may be taking the lead to help us make this change. Wouldn't you agree on that?
Absolutely. So, I mean, 2 points. First of all, the fact that HDSA's always looked at HD this way, at least for the 12 years that I've been at HDSA, we've looked at it from a comprehensive care perspective. It's why the centers of excellence have always been more than just movement disorder teams. When you think about our social workers at centers and beyond, the disability specialists that we have in Allison Bartlett, the HD Parity Act, I can go on and on. We think about all of the support that we're providing because it's not just motor, right?
Absolutely.
It's not just Korea. And so, you know, really committed to that. And I will say working with medical professionals is something that we also hold dear. When the diagnostic criteria were reevaluated by the Movement Disorder Society back starting in 2012, right? You know, we were very vocal in that process to make sure that it wasn't just Korea.
Right.
That's not HD. It needs to be comprehensive.
And I think that's kind of where we're seeing what, in my opinion, is the patients are now steering the car. It's not a race car. We still have to be patient, but I have faith that this time around that the Movement Disorder Society and the AAN will see that the patients, caregivers, and doctors are finally going on the record, Louise, because that, let's face it, you have to go on the record, and that's what we're seeing. And it's a beautiful time. It's a beautiful time.
So there is so much momentum. And as you mentioned, definitely the family voice is part of that, right? You know, the fact that there is so much family empowerment to step forward, share their stories, and demand change. That's really key. I mean, we can go back 20 years and I think about older members of my family who would never challenge their doctors, right? Would never, you know, sort of share their experience for fear that it was different from, you know, what a doctor learned, right? But now we have a much more collaborative healthcare process. We have so many different ways to share our stories and our perspectives. And so all of that gets to sort of come together, right?
Absolutely.
Back in 2014, HDSA did a survey in preparation for the FDA hearing, the voice of the patient hearing that they did in 2015. And through that process, we had 3,600 people who shared their perspectives on how HD was managed and what mattered most to them. And, you know, there were so many symptoms and strategies shared through that forum that, of course, reinforced the fact that it's not just a motor disease. And the FDA saw that. After that, the FDA really sort of blew the doors open and said, we want more patient engagement in all stages of drug development. And that's something that at HDSA we've responded with or responded to with things like HD Cope and different ways of partnering with drug developers and clinical scientists to help them really think about what treatments are going to benefit families. And that's, you know, that's our voice. We're the conscience of the community as representatives. And, you know, like we have a face and everyone engaged, our most important job is to be that voice in the room that says, are you doing this to truly meet our needs? And when we think about diagnosis, I think we also have to sort of put that lens back on, right? You know, is diagnosis serving the community as a whole and really helping families? And in the US, diagnosis has very practical, reasons, practical advantages. You can't apply for Social Security disability insurance unless you have a diagnosis. There are certain conversations that you can have with your employer only after you have a diagnosis. There are certain care regimens and conversations you can have with ancillary medical professionals that happen when you have a diagnosis. And those things are unique to the US, absolutely. But I think it's why here in the US, working with the HD Center of Excellence program at HDSA and all of our professionals, we're committed to having a fresh conversation about that.
Absolutely. I really want to thank you because although, yes, today's topic is coming up, but this was so important to have your response. And I know the HD community, patients and caregivers, and especially doctors who are watching this from other countries. The way that I look at this is someone has to be the first out of the gate. Someone has to be the one to say, okay, we have the patients, we have the families, now we have the medical professionals, and now look, we have the organizations. So Louise, I want to thank you for providing that insight because we had a lot of inquiries regarding the HDSA's stance on the project as we're speaking of. So I want to thank you for that. So now let's introduce patients like me. Tell me what it's about.
Yeah. So Patients Like Me is a new partnership that HDSA has embarked upon with Patients Like Me, which is a longtime leader in collecting patient experience. And I hate the idea of patients, right? Because in the HD community, we're not all patients, but the concept and the platform is really important in terms of creating a community organized around a health issue, in this case, Huntington's disease, where folks can come for trusted conversation. So, it's not just a Facebook equivalent, right? Where anyone can throw lots of noise out there. This is a moderated forum where folks can join and participate and share, and we'll make sure that it's accurate, right? Not in any way to manage conversations and take away free exchange, but we do want to make sure that folks have good information. So Patients Like Me is first and foremost a community, a trusted community. But secondly, and this is what makes me really excited, it's a place where we can start to gather the HD community's experience living with Huntington's disease. And I say this because when I think of all of the data that we have in the HD space, right? We have, decades of data through Predict HD and Enroll HD and clinical and observational trials of different shapes and sizes. So much of that information is clinician-reported data. So it's doctors doing evaluations or trained specialists, medical professionals, doing observations and clinical assessments about what they're seeing in a patient. What we endeavor to try and do is fill in the blind spot, which is the patient-reported experiences. And so that's what Patients Like Me can help us do. So. Okay.
And let's also underscore the security. Yes. It's extremely secure. I've been on it. I love the functionality, the ease of use, the fun parts of your day. Where you start your day, how are you feeling? And you could basically measure yourself over a long period of time from physical, emotional, mental health. You could put on your doctor's appointments, reminders. I mean, it's a plethora of space that is secure to you.
It is really important to share with everyone that HDSA never collects any of this information. So even the HD trial finder, mm-hmm. that's managed offsite, right? So that's a clinical trial search tool where you can put in your zip code and find out what HD trials are going on around you. But we have a third-party vendor specifically because we don't ever want that information, right? It needs to be anonymous. And we also develop partnerships with vendors that allow this information to be anonymous, right? You don't have to use your real name. You don't have to use a personally identifiable email address. And, you know, when it comes to zip code, you can use very inexact zip code information, right? There are lots of ways to maintain your anonymity and your privacy. And we really interrogated that very carefully with patients like me. And they're a long-time vendor. They've been doing this for more than 10 years in a variety of disease settings, right? And with the ALS community and others, they gave us confidence that they have the systems in place to keep our community safe. And that's a first and foremost for us. Absolutely. And so now, thank you for
reinforcing. No problem. Now, it's funny, let's go back because I remember looking at it and the very first thing that came to me was, oh, Facebook-ish, but it's not. So I noticed that a lot of people have started to join because it's disease specific. So you can actually, you know, join a Huntington's or you can actually go and join other diseases that are similar. There's so much that you can do. What I want you to do, Louise, is it's obvious to me, but I need for you to explain it. Why utilize this and not Facebook? Because that's what a lot of people are going to say.
So two things. First, by going to the Patients Like Me community, the information is going to be accurate. And I think there's so much fake news and noise and eager sort of trolls and marketers who live in places like Facebook that contaminate the comment fields, and they do. So somebody posts a really good question to an HD advocacy community on Facebook, and then in the 300 responses, it's really hard to know what's accurate and what's not. So we want to reduce the noise and make the communication more effective. If you're asking a question and you need help, I want you to have good information. I just do. So that's a quality of information sort of check and balance that we look at with patients like me. You're going to get more accurate information. You're going to be connected to a community that knows exactly what you're going through and can share that information with you and have the check and balances of moderators just making sure that it's fair, right? Yeah. So there's no noise.
And on the other side of that is that, because I know using it, if you see someone who's on Facebook in dire consequences of having their question answered correctly, I looked at patients like me and was like, well, this is true to form fact. So let me put that on Facebook rather than, and then actually state, this is from patients like me, join us. Mm-hmm. So, because we see it in the public groups, the private groups, where someone asks a question and there's 150 responses and there's just not enough time to go through and either vet something or whatever. We experienced that with the HD Parity Act. No, I'm sorry, not Parity Act, the disability portion, which is we had so much misinformation on Facebook. That's why I asked Allison to come onto the TV show so that there's that video as a tool as well for people who just have no clue what to do when it comes to completing the disability portion. So I liked it and I did, you know me, I'm gonna go through and rip it apart and look at it. Yeah. And I said, you know, I liked that when you click on me, it brings me all of my personal information so I can keep track. You know, people have different devices that they keep track on. But what I love about it, there's an app for it. So you can have it on every device you have and they streamline. So if you're wanting to communicate with someone, you can do it on all the devices. So the formatting of it is simply beautiful. And I do like the fact that it is administrated by someone who knows what they're talking about. So that's the feedback that I wanted to give you as well.
thank you for that. And I always listen to that lived experience, right? So I want folks to go in and you know, kick the tires, make sure that it's working for them, right? And if it's not, let us know. The only fire that we can put out is the one we know of, right? So like, let us know so we can fix it. So you asked sort of why patients like me, and I would say first is that community, right? The trusted information. I want to reduce the time that folks have to wait for good information, right? You know, so there's so much information out in social media that it's very often hard to know what to trust. And it's also not in a perfect community. There was somebody posted a comment, Lord knows, in June asking for help that because of the algorithms of Facebook got lost, and it took a month for them to get an answer that connected them to a care provider local to them.
Right.
Whereas if you're in, you know, a moderated community, that wait time is going to be reduced. So that's really important. So the patients like me community improves the trust, hopefully, that folks can have in the information that they're seeing and sharing. But secondly, you mentioned the app as a way to sort of share personal information. If you are someone who wants to share your experience to help inform care, then doing it through patients like me is a way that we can build a body of experiential evidence related to what HD families are going through. And so once the community is built a little bit more, right, we'd like to have sort of a solid mass, you know, in terms of numbers of folks who are interacting, we're going to start to, you know, deploy surveys that allow us, for the folks who choose, it's all opt-in, to share their experiences around certain topics. And it, you know, it's all going to be blinded information, right? So from HDSA's perspective, we're never going to see the specifics of somebody's journey. And patients like me protects all of that. But over time, we're going to be able to build more of the story of what an HD family goes through in terms of time to diagnosis, time to access care, challenges with the genetic testing, unique challenges of JHD families. So we really want to build that information, again, to fill in that blind spot. There's so much, you know, doctor-reported information, clinical observers, you know, let's round out that story by making sure that the family perspective is shareable and that it's data-driven in a way that can inform drug development. And, you know, James, back to this conversation of diagnosis, I think it's important because there's a lot of noise right now about different ways to diagnose for clinical studies, right? Like different staging systems and different biomarkers that different companies are looking at to consider the course of the disease from a drug development perspective. That's important, super important, and HDSA engaged in that. But also as important, if not more so, is the practical stuff we need to do today for families to be able to access the care. And that's why this project can't be separated from the other, but needs to have sort of a unique perspective and voice.
Yeah, I think that, like I said, we're putting together a puzzle. And the more pieces that we have, the quicker the puzzle can be put together. And I think harnessing all of these avenues, platforms, what have you, we are in still the COVID days. It's sad. But if we've learned anything, we've learned to continue to use what we have at our disposal to move our mission, education, information, resources, togetherness. That is key. And I think utilizing these platforms will benefit the whole sector of what we're trying to complete. And that's why we're seeing this rally, because everyone is so fired up with, wow, we can make change. We could take advantage of what we have. And it's a great time, in my opinion. I think the more and more people that sign up on patients like me. It's a different flavor. And I know people are like, oh, I don't want another social platform. But my advice is try it out, because you can sign on as Ronald McDonald if you want. It doesn't matter. The key that I'm wanting you to look at, and I'm asking all my patients and caregivers to just try it out. When you are on there, it just gives you a different feel than the Facebook. Don't get me wrong. We all use Facebook. I use Facebook. Hello. But when you're on that platform, I hate to use the word safe, because the only other word that I can picture is we're compartmentalized. So it's Huntington's, everything Huntington's related. You're not looking at someone's recipe or something off the cuff. This is so targeted about you, the patient and caregiver, and all of your fellow patient and caregivers that are giving advice, taking advice, and need that extra support, because even the buttons are different. You click on support, it shows that person you're supporting them. Private messaging, same similar venue and way of doing it, but safe, yes, but you feel like you're in your own space. I don't know how else to say it, Louise.
Yeah, no, I think that's really important. So we've made it easy for folks to join the Huntington's disease community on Patients Like Me. So it is hdsa.org/PLM. And what you do there is you join specifically the HDSA HD community. But then something you share, James, is that Patients Like Me is a lot more than HD, right? And so what that means is that if you are a caregiver, if you are really struggling with anxiety, you can join additional communities organized around those, you know, concurrent situations, right?
Yeah.
So that when you are joining your Patients Like Me or logging on to your Patients Like Me profile, you're going to see the activity from the HD community, but then also you're going to have information specific, in this example, to caregivers and to anxiety that also is very tailored to what you're going through. And again, that's different than what Facebook or Twitter or Instagram or anything else is allowing, because it really is health journey focused.
Yes.
And it's all free.
Yes.
So, you know, and I think that sounds silly, but there's a lot of fee for service resources right now. And, you know, our commitment to the community has always been that calling our social workers, talking with Allison for disability, the telehealth program we have with Amwell for counseling, like that's all free by design. We want to remove barriers to care. And at Patients Like Me, we're removing barriers to community, right? And that's important for us.
Absolutely. Well, we are out of time, Louise, but it has been amazing. Promise me you'll come back on. I want to talk about this again, specifically the Patients Like Me, when we've seen a growth in this, because I think we are going to. I think people are going to look into this, and they may stay or they may go, but at least we can hopefully connect with people, patients like me. So I want to thank you so much for coming on today, Louise. It's been a blessing to have you.
Always a pleasure, James. Yes. Thank you.
No problem. All right. Well, I want to thank all of you for watching today's episode, and stay tuned. We're going to have many, many, many more shows with some incredible organizations, patients and caregivers and medical professionals, all about the specific topic about changing the current diagnostic criteria for Huntington's, because together we are better and we are going to make this change. We're not in a race car, but we are in the car and we are taking the wheel. We are taking the lead, and it's because of you. So I want to always make sure that you know you are loved.